Ed, my name's Ann Gaines. I'm Dean for the School of Art, Media, and Technology here at Parsons School of Design. And I really want to just take a moment and thank all of the organizers and the participants. What a brilliant day, right? How many of you in the audience about a year ago received an email from Anesh Kashyapik inviting you to an immersive storytelling conversation? A few of us? Yeah, oh good, I'm glad you're here today. I want to thank Anesh for initiating this university-wide conversation here at the New School. It's reflective of what's been evolving over decades with our faculty and students, but it's also forward-looking in terms of the potential for positive impact and presence across this emerging landscape across our fields of theory and practice. And I myself am so interested in how virtual and augmented reality and 360 imaging create access opportunities. So in celebrating this insightful, critical dialogue that we've had today, and I've really been noting the range of voices, the thoughtful curation of these panels, I want to celebrate and acknowledge all of the sources that made the symposium possible. This was a faculty-led endeavor, and I want to recognize the 6 faculty that applied for and received a Parsons Cross-School Fund to seed the symposium. There, you saw many of them here today: Jess Irish, Jane Perrone, Kyle Lee, Nick Fortunio, Greg Clymer, and Anesh Kashyapik. Yeah, give them a hand. I also want to extend my gratitude to Jessica Haymonick and the University Nth Degree Series, and Justin Hendricks with New York City Media Lab. We so appreciated your sponsorship. And now it's my pleasure to get our keynote discussion started. So please join me in welcoming Tim Marshall, Provost for the New School, and Jessica Brillhart, Principal Filmmaker for Google VR. In 2009, Brillhart joined Google's Creative Lab, where she spearheaded numerous award-winning shorts and documentaries before joining the VR team in 2015. Since directing World Tour, the first VR film made with the Jump ecosystem, Brillhart has continued traveling the world, filming and experimenting, all in an effort to better understand and help inform others about this emergent medium. Jessica, thanks for joining us today, and we're all looking forward to the conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can everyone hear us okay? So, quick confession, when Anesh first came to ask me to do this, I did actually quickly point out to her, like, why are you asking me? Because I basically know nothing about VR or AR or MR or...
I don't either.
Good.
This is going to be a great conversation.
So this is going to be a great conversation. And she said, perfect, that's great, that's what we want. And so once I realized that she was looking for someone who could have opinions about something he didn't know anything about, then a provost makes perfect sense, because that is kind of in the job description of being a provost. So bear with me, but for that reason, I'm going to be quick. I did come through the world of art and photography, so I'm not completely illiterate around areas of visuality and what have you, but I just don't know this world very well. But what I want to know, Jessica, from you as part of your just getting us going and locate, sort of grounding us in this conversation, is like what attracted you into VR? What draws you toward it? What's the alluring pieces of it, the positive pieces of it? And because you came out of filmmaking yourself, out of music video and out of documentary and what have you, and so constant, is it the technological change per se that draws you in, or is there some quality, distinct quality about VR that just creatively
It's a lot of different things. I think, you know, I've worked at Google for quite some time. When I was at NYU, I was studying film and then, you know, also studying computer applications. So I was actually very interested in the way the technology influenced society and culture and how we responded to it. At the time, a lot of talk around the internet and how that changed the way that we dealt with each other in the world. I was learning Perl server-side stuff and I hated it. So there were like definitely things within like the technology front that I was like, nope, not gonna do it. But I was really inspired by it. And I felt that technology, there's really this really interesting thing that technology does as a portal, as a conduit through which people who are developing the technology and the people using it.
Right.
Like, there's a story there. There are stories in that line of communication. Mm-hmm. So that's what got me into just working in tech and right. being a filmmaker and trying to use what I learned as a filmmaker and apply that to the technology world on right. some level. And I actually, I don't know if this is, we'll see if this works. If you don't mind going to the slides real quick instead of this one. Can we do it? I believe in you. Yes, the beginning. Go. Okay, so here are actually two of the reasons why I got involved. The first is this, which is was the prototype of the jump rig. So some of you may know if you're interested in live action VR filmmaking, for lack of a better word. And it was the first thing that I saw. A group of engineers basically reached out to me and said, hey, we know we're building this thing. We don't know what to do with it. We'd love to get right. your opinions on it. And when I got to Seattle, I saw this. And I mean, this is awesome. I think this looks better than what's out there now. Don't tell Google, but I guess. I just love it because, I mean, interchangeable cameras, I mean, words I can't say to work with, but I loved it because you saw the Sharpie, we would mark it, the cameras had to be in order, there are really cool things that happened when you didn't have them in order, but this is what I had to work with. Mm-hmm. And I just, you know, the engineers there were like, okay, so...
Go for it.
Go for it. And I'm like, I'm sorry, what? Like, what? Like, what do I... And I was like, I don't even know how to turn the damn thing on. Like, which camera do I press, and like, what's the thing? But it was then that we actually both started to come together and really work with it together. So they told me which camera to right. turn on, and I basically did a bunch of stuff that people do now. Like, I was putting it on dolly tracks and spinning it around really quickly and putting it ground level and just doing whatever, you right. know, with it. And, you know, as I was doing it, I also was reminded of this, which is... this is the first stitch that this team actually was able to put together. You know, they had done a couple of things. They had done, like, you know, outside of University of Washington, they did something at KXP with musicians all around you. I'm sure you're familiar with that thing. But this is amazing. And this has always been the thing that really struck me as being really powerful because you felt how happy they were. Like, you really got it, like, you were just like, and they were happy at you. It wasn't like they were happy and you were like, oh, look, they were looking at you with just such joy and such, like, pleasure that I was like, this is absolutely phenomenal. This is everything I've always wanted to do when it came to film and trying to embrace whatever that kind of communication was between, like, the engineers working with right. the technology and what the technology right. was actually doing.
So with that, I mean, because there's, you know, in the last panel this came up about how do we define this space? I mean, is it 360 video or not? Is it?
I hate that argument. Yeah. Can I just say that right now? Yeah, I do not give a damn if you make a 360 video, if you make right. something positional. That whole argument is so bizarre to me because it's like, when do you stop?
Right.
Like, when is it VR? When you right. have, like, six senses and a right. biohaptic suit and you can, like, be underwater and you can speak whale? Like, what? What? Like,
that's my own experience.
You know, like, at what point? I think it's fascinating to have... I do agree that right now, in terms of the video spectrum of things, in terms of live action capture, it's fairly limited because of the nature of technology. But right. I also believe that those limitations allow for great things to happen. Mm. And you can get a lot out of that.
Right.
And I think as long as you can... basically, you know, have someone believe that they're somewhere else, where their mind is engaged in a way that right. they believe that they are somewhere else,
right.
which I've seen some great 360 video film pieces do just that,
right.
then I think you've done it.
Right.
I think you've tapped into something that's fundamental to VR and what VR is capable
right.
of doing.
Right, right.
Yeah.
So, and how do you make decisions about when VR is a right approach? So, yeah. I looked at three... In my homework, I did three fast viewings of New York Times VR videos.
Okay.
One of which I thought was completely banal and redundant, and I couldn't understand why they use VR. Uh-huh. One was like, yeah, sort of, maybe I could kind of get it.
Yeah.
Because it was like, come along for the ride kind of a thing. And sure. the third one, actually, I thought, wow, that's something really distinctly different.
Do you remember?
Which... Yeah. One was really doing, it was more like a documentary film, where the filmic language seemed to be important, the editorial, and it was filmed like a film, but in VR, and it just seemed redundant. I would have preferred to have watched that as a documentary film.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't see the point that I could see around this space. Like, there was no,
right.
there was no content there that was actually compelling. The other one, which was just come along for the ride, was kind of interesting. but a little more techie. And the other third one was in a refugee camp. And actually, I was just watching it, expecting to be against the idea, but I actually found, this was quite different. I actually felt quite different.
Yeah.
There were people talking to me in different spaces, and it was interesting. And I actually felt less like a narrative in a filmic sense, and much more like a campfire kind of conversation. I was in their world in a different way than I would have been in a straight two-dimensional sense. So
yeah, I mean, I did this exercise with a dystopic sci-fi novel, that I will go a name for now. But a director basically said, like, hey, I've been really thinking about ways that I could put VR or use VR for this. So I said, okay, great. So what I did is I read the book. And I basically went through, I read it once, and then went through, and I basically highlighted what could be VR in pink, and then in like some kind of pink, or sorry, in like a yellow-orange sheet thing, which was maybe a mistake, because now they both look the same, is the stuff that I felt from a cinematic standpoint it would be better suited.
Right.
And I found that there are definitely things that pull you in emotionally in the cinematic way, and there's stuff that really pulls you in emotionally from like, I need to be there to really understand. Mm. A lot of that involves, for me, the idea of consciousness and perception, how one's view of a world is much more deeply set than my objective take on it. And I find
that... Can you explain that a little bit more?
Sure. Yeah.
Deeply set in the sense that
I feel like there's...
in a way,
right, where I feel like there's something that we bring, our minds bring to it. Like that, I think someone in the previous panel said absorption, which is closer. I feel like, I kind of feel a bit like we need to, there needs to be a capacity for the person in the experience to seep and sort of just spread themselves in it and then be able to sort of attach themselves to that experience in that way. And if there's value in that, then I think that VR is perfect.
Right.
If it's like, I honestly just need to tell you something, and it's really important that I tell you, then that there are other mediums that are much easier to work with than VR. Because I do think that VR, from a seeping out standpoint, like I hate it when people are, maybe it's just I have a love for people now suddenly. So I love you, all of you.
Made you empathic.
I know, it's a little bit of a change in the past couple of weeks to say that to people.
Exactly.
But I think it's to me, it feels more like I like it when people rebel. I like it when people don't look in the direction that I want them what I would want them to look. I hate that I want that.
Right.
I think that there's something to be said about you being able to understand something on a very fundamental level by looking in whatever direction you want, by doing whatever you want. And my job is really to understand what those potential permeations could be and craft for that.
Right.
One of the, perhaps, let's go to the slides, I think. One of the things I've been thinking a lot about is this idea of frames and worlds, right? Where, you know, it's tricky to know where someone's going to look, and they could potentially look anywhere. So one of the things I've been doing is thinking about it less like a frame and more like this, where I can actually see all the potentials for everything. And then, you know, you basically have something that doesn't look like a frame anymore. It kind of looks like that. And that's not even right, right? I kind of almost want a sphere.
Right.
Or like something like an Alexander Calder element on a mobile, where it's like there's more engagement over here, so it's a little bit more bulbous, and it's thinner on the other side. But that actually goes into this idea of editing as well, where we always think of, you know, going from frame to frame to frame, where I want versus where you want. And you know, honestly, the first thing I made, I did this, and it was awful. And I felt like when I was in it that someone was like doing a grave disservice to me, and I was being completely disrespected, and I hated the editor. And the editor was me, so that was weird. And so I kind of had to go back and think, well, you know, we make these, we capture these worlds, and they're all very different. And they all, you know, you think about all the places you go to, and they all, you know, from basketball games to, you know, to your family home, to a theater like this, where there are very specific places that we do engage with, and they have particular functions and so on. So it kind of makes me think of it as, like, what we're really trying to do is create and craft universes, and understand what each world is capable of doing.
Right.
And then you start editing becomes something that's a little bit more like this, where your job is to really pull someone through that universe and find the, you know, and how you do that and what compels you to do that. That's the craft, and that's the altership, I think, is figuring out what the best way to do this is. Additionally, that too is the fact that, like, the viewer frame thing, like the viewer idea, calling someone a viewer is actually it hurts
right.
more than it helps.
Right.
We call it that because, especially in 360 film, because we're like, oh, but I'm standing there and I'm just looking at stuff. We never just look at stuff.
Right.
That never happens. Right. Like when we're actually somewhere, we engage.
Right.
We're listening. We're thinking about what we had for breakfast. We're thinking about how this relates to the thing that we're doing or not. You're thinking back to other things that you have witnessed, what you're going to do later. So really, if you have a world and you throw someone in it, what you're trying to do is introduce the visitor to that world. And once you have a visitor, suddenly everything becomes, the medium becomes less about a disembodied medium, where all we're trying to do is communicate with someone out there something that is happening over here. But this is about embodiment.
Right.
This is about, you know, how do you use someone's presence and their being there to then understand how you craft worlds and have that kind of conversation with someone.
But a lot of, in doing that, a lot of, as you've just pointed out,
yeah,
a lot of your filmic language is no longer relevant, right? There's no composition, framing, the sort of traditional methods, or are they?
I think all mediums have variations
how do you
construct
this thing?
Yeah, I think all mediums have variations of that. They're not called the same thing, but they're similar.
Right.
I think that a lot of, I feel like when big institutions kind of come up to me and say like, hey, we want to do VR, and I'm like, okay, like, what do you have in mind? And of course, the first round of ideas are usually not that great. They're like, behind the scenes, and you're like, okay, which is fine. You know, there's something to be said for that. But I'm always just like, instead of thinking about, you ask them why VR, like, why do you want to do VR? And usually, generally, if it's an older institution, it's to attract new audiences, to reimagine what this medium is like, to bring people there to immerse, to create empathy. And they all don't, they're words that don't really mean a whole lot.
Right.
They're just sort of like, I like to do that thing that someone did once. It's like, okay, great. What you really want to do is you want to have a new piece of technology that people will stand in line for that will make you feel special.
Right.
Got it, good, that's fine. But what do you actually want to do? Mm. Like, what do you think VR can bring to the medium that you do? And instead of asking them what excites them most, I actually end up asking them what frustrates them about it.
Hmm.
Like, because I mean, every medium at this point, from opera to dance to gaming to filmmaking, they all have tension points.
Right.
And in those tension points, and mine was editing, to be very honest, like that's what sort of got me on this.
Right.
The tension points are the most interesting.
Yeah.
The tension points are where the medium is saying, hey, I'm different. I'm like doing something unique.
Right.
You're ignoring this, but you should pay attention, because I think those are the points where, if you really break it apart, if you think, well, why is it why is it a problem? What am I really trying to do here? And what is this saying that I cannot do? And what does that mean for how I think of what's a priority for what I want to do for this? Then you start to really, not only, you change the conversation from how can VR help my medium? It's more like how can my medium help VR?
Right.
Like how can what I do and what I care about and what I'm passionate about help people in VR better understand what it's capable of doing? And so I feel like that's the tension points. There are the things that are really fun, and I mean, like, why be easy with it, right? It's not easy. So for me, like, editing was one. Moving the camera, obviously, is another.
Right.
This idea of like, how can you move a rig? A lot of it comes down to how you can compel someone to want to move, and if you can compel them to want to move. Like, it's funny, if I were like to try
the
to
viewer,
punch you,
like,
I'm not going to. But if I tried to punch you, you'd probably, even if I pretended it, your mind's thinking, like, move away. And that, I've just compelled you to move,
right?
So I'm not saying you should try to punch everybody that comes into your VR experience, but, I mean, the act of someone unfamiliar moving towards you generally makes us feel a little uneasy. So we generally are like, can we move back a little bit? And then suddenly, if someone's moving and you're moving back, you suddenly have the capacity to move someone. So again, it's not the, it's the, people are like, oh, well, either I'm going to make you sick or, you know, I'm not going to move you. It's like, okay, well, when we move, why are we moving? There's something going on.
So is this your man with a movie camera moment where everyone runs out of the cinema screaming because they think the train's going to run them down?
Or they say that, I'll make up that lie so that someone in the future can use that for their new medium and then I can move on. But no, I think that if that happens, fine. But I think it's more, I like it when most, like my mom saw the latest piece that I did, which was on the Montreal Canadiens, ice hockey. She's from Singapore. She's never seen an ice hockey game in her life. She was in it, and she just kept saying, this is brain stuff, isn't it? And I was like, what? Like, when did you start talking like that? And I think, I mean, to have someone who's generally, it's not like, I mean, she's very, very smart. It's not, but she, I think the fact that she's starting to talk like that, if I can get people thinking like that, right. And really starting to figure that part out for themselves, I feel like that I've accomplished quite a bit. Like one of these scenes, I gotta show you this one, because yeah. This is one of my favorite, sorry, ignore okay. It's gonna be, oh, this is good. So one of the things that I actually thought quite a bit about is this idea of attention, sort of like where people pay attention to in a right. scene. So if you're in a glacier scene or a glacier world, unless you like benign glacier stuff, which is fine, that's cool too, you will pay attention to the only human being in it that's moving and making a noise, which is this glacier climber. So even though I don't have 100% guarantee you're gonna be engaging in that direction, I can make a pretty strong bet. So a lot of it's based on probability, right? You can actually start crafting this stuff and editing based upon understanding
right.
where people are gonna be looking. And so like, you know, if I can make a bet on that, then suddenly that makes sense and I can start, you know, futzing with it a bit. Like I can take you to another world where in that same region you were engaged with in the world before, there's something interesting in that right. one that I would right. like for you to catch. And one of my favorite examples of this is actually in that same piece that my mom saw about the, and I don't know, they were just so great for letting me be on the ice. I can't ice skate, so this was really funny. pushing out a rig in the middle of the torch ceremony for a game that's sold out. So this, what I did was, I took where I presumed someone would be looking, which is a, you know, the torch ceremony, something's on fire, lots of movement, you know, you got your players there. And this is what I did with the next world. So there are a couple of things here. One, you know, I could have just, you know, used the ice hockey rink, right? I could have just like, you're looking at the torch ceremony, so the next logical thing is the ice hockey rink, right? So you know where you're going, you know what's going on. But inevitably, someone's gonna eventually try to find out where that thing is. And beyond that, that guy's awesome. He's the best part of the entire film, I think. Forget the ice hockey players, but like, you would have missed him.
Right.
Entirely.
Yeah, totally.
If I
yeah.
had, maybe by chance you would have seen
yeah.
him. And the great part is he actually, we did a heat map test of this actually and had people look, and everyone was spot on doing this. They were looking mm-hmm. at the torch, then they looked at him. And what mm-hmm. he does, which is if you look at any sort of market, like website research stuff, because we all do, right? If there's a human and some text, people generally look at the human and not the text. But if the human looks at the text, yeah. then people generally start with the human, but then they engage with
go
the text.
Follow the line of sight.
Exactly. So if you see this guy sort of giving you a look over, being like, why are you here? But then he turns. Generally, you've connected with him long enough mm. that you turn to see what he's looking at.
Right.
And suddenly the rink is revealed. Mm. And that, to me, is the craft of this. Yeah. It's like playing with what's there in the world and playing with possible engagement and seeing what can come out of that. I could have also just cut to like a bunch of random fans, but that would have just been like what
right.
you know, you could. It wouldn't have been very useful.
So how do you think the technology is going to evolve? I mean, there's the goggles and we're going to get rid of those soon. Is it?
I mean, it's
light form?
Someone mentioned Hamlet on the Holodeck too. Janet Murray is a friend actually, which is funny because like we basically can riff off each other for a while and argue, but we end up kind of wanting the same thing, which is fun. And she, you know, her want for the holodeck is my want for it too.
Right.
You know, no, having technology be, having something that's room scale or beyond that fits in a space that you determine. There's nothing on your face.
Right.
Like there's nothing on your face. It's not run, like the batteries are infinite, right? Like there's no device that you have to rely on. The audio is actually like mixed well and is good
right.
and like people care about the audio.
Right.
I would love that.
Yeah, that'd be
good. And I try very hard to keep that yeah. going as much right. as I can. I will say from a VR video standpoint, just as a side note, I think that without spatial audio, it will become viewer to frame
mm-hmm.
because the audio is such a huge part of this.
Right.
And I always felt that it actually helps me edit, helps me engage with someone if that's correct
right.
and done right. So I actually feel like a lot of the technology will be like the best kind of technology,
right.
which it just disappears.
Right.
It seems like it's not there.
Right.
And you have the capacity to engage the way that you'd like.
Then you really are immersed, in that
mm-hmm.
sense.
Yeah, yeah.
So given, I mean, a lot of what you're saying is coming out of a film out of film, at
mm-hmm.
least to my ears. And the whole question, this symposium is about storytelling. And when I've read up about it, it's like this whole question of storytelling in VR seems a little complicated. Some people think it's a terrible medium for storytelling, even people working in VR. Others, that film is not really the thing. And it seems like there's these two long histories, right? One is short-term histories of going right back. There's Margaret Wertheim, some of you might know, wrote a book 15 years ago saying VR's kind of founding moment was Giotto's chapel in Assisi, because it was the first time you ever actually tried to convince people that they were in a space of reality, not depicting something. And then you go through phantasmagoria work and magic lanterns and, you know, blah, 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 panoramas. And these are all short-lived, often like wow things, like people flock to them, stereography and things like that, and they get really into them and then they go. And then there's this longer history of cameras and film, photography and film, and then 3D. And in here we seem to be, it's all colliding together in a really interesting way. So as it collides together, what gets thrown forward? Do you think it, in terms of storytelling, in terms of how we understand film now and movie and narrative versus experience versus immersion?
Right.
So on and so
forth. I think storytelling is a terrible thing to call this medium. Sorry if that's offends anybody, but I really don't. I think it's sort of like immersion or empathy or presence, where it's all like, but what does it mean? That to me is the biggest tension point. And that's the part that I find very fascinating, because it's a word that means that it's basically like, okay, so I need you to understand something very specific to how I perceive the world. I need you to get that. And so it's my filtered experience told to you. And it's never one-to-one. Like, we're kidding ourselves. I think someone said at the last panel, too, where, like, you have to then use your reference points from your experience to then make reference to what I might be saying. So even if I give you a visual representation, that's still you seeing that in light of your other visual references for what that thing is or what that person could be. So if someone smirks on screen, you know that that person could be lying. They could be know something that I don't. I mean, it's based upon other references that we've had before. So there's depth to that. I feel like the telling part of storytelling is the thing that VR is not good at doing, for a lot of good reasons. It's hard. I mean, if it would be easy, we would be able to do it pretty simply, because there have been a lot of other mediums that have given us reference, but it just doesn't work the same way. As soon as you have the agency to look away or engage somewhere else or to bring yourself or seep yourself into a space, you then have to think about like how worlds are less about this tightly wound atom of stuff that I've perceived, that you must perceive, to become something much like a universe where it just the atom just explodes. And I have to basically understand, okay, like, how do I craft a world that is seemingly made by some kind of creator? It starts to get heavy if you're thinking it goes into religion. It does. And so you really start to think about, like, okay, well, when I have a bottle of water, you know, if I want to tell a story of a bottle of water, but I don't think someone may see that bottle of water, how can I, and that's really important, like, how can I create a world that feels like a bottle of water? We may not get bottle of water, it may not be as direct, but if I do want to give you sort of a chance to seep in, I might make, you know, if it's pull and spring, you know, maybe it's in a forest, I don't know. Maybe it's like there's symbols of wetness around. Maybe a sink is left on. Maybe, you know, you're meant to feel thirsty, so I actually put you in a completely different space where it's like the opposite of what a bottle of water would be. Because then you start really thinking about, oh my God, I would love a bottle of water. You know, like this, there are ways that you can kind of play with that depending on what you're trying to accomplish. And I think what I love doing is, you know, I'll take a story, like a fable usually, where there's usually a point or a truth to it, something like the tortoise and the hare, right? And you think about, okay, so slow and steady wins the race is the end point. Now, if I'm doing a VR experience and I'm trying to make you the tortoise, you would be bored out of your mind, because you're like, I want to go fast. Like, what? No one wants to go that slow. That you don't, at the end, will say, oh, I won, therefore great. You know, it's... if you're the hare, if you're a ghost, a ghost which is what most VR things are, is like, you're a ghost. It's like, okay, that's fine.
You mean your presence in it is ghost?
Yeah, it's like you're there, but you're not really there. No one really cares that you're there, but you're there. It's like, okay. I mean, that's fine, but in certain cases, it's great. But for something like this, it's so much better to be the hare, because we all want to be the hare. We all want to go really fast. That's who we are. But if you lose, then being the hair actually sucks, and you don't want to lose, right? So the idea is, like, how can you be the hair and win, even though you inevitably lose the race? So you think about, like, well, what if as the hair...
Or if you lose, you're going to feel better about yourself if you're the tortoise, right?
Yeah, yeah, totally. I want to be that guy. So it's like, well, what if in that last nap that you take, where the tortoise supersedes you and wins, you actually, you decide to leave. And as you leave, you meet a bunch of new friends, you play some games, you watch a sunset, you sort of go on this journey that's completely different than the race or the point of the race. And as you go, you come back and you realize you've lost, but you've won. You've had a slew of other experiences by just taking the time to go and explore.
Right.
So suddenly it becomes, slow and steady wins the race, but I could still be the hare.
Right.
But I could be a hare that's changed,
right?
And I think that that's to me kind of where, that's where the medium can kind of help, show you stories or have stories reveal themselves to you.
So you mean it makes us slow ourselves down to some degree and really, is it a new curiosity that's being inspired?
We are going to be a magnitude out of what happens. Right. So I'm going to flip through some slides that are, heat map, sorry.
That's where people are looking?
That's where people are looking. Right. You're going to see a bunch of stuff I've been thinking about. I'm just going to flip through. Yeah. Oh, this is fun. So this is, if you know where people are going to, never mind. If you know where people are going to look, you can actually start to create like a cipher.
Okay.
We can move people through it. Rebellion, this is another interesting thing. It's like, what if you don't have them look in the direction you want them to look? So I do this actually in the scene in a film with called Resonance. And the whole point of the film is for you, the scene is a girl, young girl playing violin. Like, if you see that and you engage with that, you did it. Like, that's the whole point.
Right.
But, what if you look the other direction? And so what I do is I actually put her parents in the doorway on the other side. So actually, if you turn around, you just watch her parents kind of, observing their kid. And I would argue that this is actually, if you're talking cinema, this is actually more cinematic because you're hearing her play violin behind you. And you're watching the expression on her parents understand like what's going on. So you sort of get a much larger representation of what's happening. And you get more context, and it becomes a much more enriching experience for someone. That's the larger picture. Engagement, what if there's more than one place to look? This idea that I can use the windows, so I can extend someone's engagement by looking through windows. So I can keep it consistent with the next world, or I can respond to it. So if you look through a side window in this tram, I can actually meet you with a horse face. And it's better in VR, obviously. Like, this isn't really what it's meant for, but if you're imagining you're kind of gazing out something and suddenly a horse face just comes at you, it's nice. It's like a conversation with somebody. The idea of moving, spatially understanding where someone is, where they're engaging with, actually helps. Because then you can actually move someone through a space. It's difficult if you move them and then you switch the thing 180 degrees or whatever. You kind of have to find a point where you can pivot around. And I've been exploring this more in a couple of pieces that are going to come out soon. This idea of revealing, this is me falling on my butt. And if you don't see, the idea, I'm fine, I'm okay. It was really fun, actually. I show this to a friend of mine Glenn Keane, who animated Little Mermaid, if any of you know who that guy is. But he's such a lovely man. He's so concerned about everything that when he saw this, he's like, what happened to her? And I'm like, I'm fine. He goes, no, her. I'm like, she's me. He goes, what? And I'm just like, okay, never mind. It's not important. But the idea is that I don't put that front and center. I make it something that's discoverable. It's something that is revealed to you, and so it actually is like these little Easter eggs that you can find along some of my pieces.
It's beautiful.
Complicate, I don't know what to call this, but it's basically like, as a filmmaker, the cleaner it is, the worse it is, because engagement-wise, you want people to work through stuff.
Mm.
So it's actually better to have someone like walking through pillars and doing more in line with that. This is like a quick, by the way, people move in real life. And so you have to really think about physically how people are engaging, because otherwise you're just completely getting rid of half. So something that I do is I actually think about how much someone's actually turning in my pieces, or how much I believe they might turn in order to get what I'm trying to.
Bodily turning around.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. because I don't want you like swinging yourself back and like all the way around. It doesn't do anyone any lick of good, so I keep this going. So it's nice to occasionally throw something in where a full turn would be nice, but I also want to give them room to explore. And this actually goes into what we were talking about, where I'm thinking about world function just as much as I'm thinking about what's actually in the scene. So this is what an edit looks like for me for World Tour. The first one I made, it gets vastly more complex.
What do you mean it's an edit? Explain that. What's
so each color corresponds with physically what the person is doing. Each white point represents where I believe a visitor will likely engage. Okay. And the black point is where what I meet them with.
But that's you imagining that. That's not actually what's happening.
I mean, no, it's a probability. Exactly. Yeah. It's like what's most likely to happen.
That's how you actually auteur it.
Yeah, exactly. Like how you can decide you want them to turn around all the time.
Right.
And then it's all red. And that's maybe the point of it, right? Where it's anxiety. You meant someone to feel uncomfortable.
So it's a frequency in different forms of.
Exactly. And like sometimes you want to feel a little uncomfortable, but you don't want to feel uncomfortable all the time. But it could be that the subject is asking for that.
Right.
For this case, if it's about tourism or traveling, then it's a little bit more about sort of an ebb and flow of sometimes you're turning, sometimes you're not, sometimes you're relaxing, sometimes there's anything's possible, you'll look anywhere. This idea of perception, too, is big for me. I work with this great team at Google called the Artists and Machine Intelligence Group, and they are a team of machine learning researchers who work out of Seattle also, conveniently right next to the jump team. They never talk, but they will, but they started to. And this is why I worked with this guy, Doug Fritz, and I took something that I had filmed, and they did something called Daydream on top of it. So again, better, much better when you see it in VR, you see like, you know, eyes and various other things, and this is like peanut butter method. It's like just slapping it on top, but I believe that there's a way that we can isolate it and then use it to help reimagine certain objects. So if you're talking about memories or dreams in your piece, you can suddenly actually have something that looks like or feels like a dream.
Right.
Because filmmakers trying to do dreams, sometimes we're okay with it, but there's a wall, you know?
They often date very fast, have you noticed?
What's up?
Dreamscapes often date very quickly visually.
Yes, they do.
It's really
strange. Yeah, absolutely.
Somehow we keep changing the way we want to visually represent dreams.
So it's nicer when a system does it, because they're like, this is sort of what your brain does,
right,
you know, then you don't have to think about it so much. And the crazy part is, so the difference, I mean, it's anything from, this is someone that on the jump team who did this as a joke. So you see like puppy slug, possum, boats, I don't know. But this is someone else from the AMI team who did the same thing with different parameters, and suddenly you have this beautiful landscape of pagodas and ice glacier sculptures and things like that. So you can change the parameters.
Right.
It's not like the system does it and I step back and
just let it rip.
Yeah, and then I think this was sort of what we talked about too. World function, so rocks, I can't tell where anyone's gonna look, but that's not really the point of rocks, right? Like, you don't go to Iceland because you want to point, what's that?
What is the point of rocks?
I don't know. But what's really interesting is if you think about gaming.
Right. By the way, we have a faculty member researching rocks in Iceland, just so you know.
Great. I got so much VR stuff.
Yeah.
It's great.
No,
you have all of it. Yeah. So many rocks. My team was like, why are there so many rocks?
Yeah.
Like, what did you do? Mm. But then they looked at it and they're like, this is pretty good.
Yeah.
I was like, I know. But the thing about rocks is if you think about some of the best games where you enter the world, Myst being one of them, and it's a very simple place, and you're not required to do anything right off the bat, but they do want you to understand and be acclimated to the fact that you are in a different space. We all have that. Like, that is just how
Basics.
Things are with life. Like, you don't have to necessarily do it, but it will be a lot more comfortable for someone.
Right.
And a lot of times what happens is people go into a VR space, and they are just like, I'm in VR, and they don't turn. They're just like VR, and in a Vive, like in a room scale setup, like someone literally has to push me for me to know that I can walk.
Right.
And I work in this.
Right.
Like I sometimes you need something to remind someone of that. So what I did with World Tour is I have the rock scene, it's the first thing you see, and you're kind of like, all right, VR, cool, that's okay, I get it. But then in the next piece, you're in the glacier area, and then the audio of the person is behind you, and then you discover the glacier climber, and suddenly you understand tools. I can turn around, and there'll probably be something behind me, might be something behind me, and there's audio that's going to help me guide me through this. So you're sort of building up of
right.
off of experiences. I don't know what this was. Oh.
There's something
worlds.
I want to ask you about these worlds you're
yeah,
creating.
Yeah, yeah, please.
It's because and it's something you've written about. It's the ethics of what you're doing in some ways. Like you're bringing someone into this space.
Yeah.
And it's kind of I think as you say, a fairly extreme responsibility that you have when you do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, do you think that we have the both actual tools in terms of protocols, policies, laws to deal with this? Or is it more libertarian, let everything go, and we'll work it out as Mm-mm. we go along? How
no,
do you feel about all that?
No, I can't remember, I don't remember right. the name of the consortium, mm-hmm. but there is a team, which I think it's Google, I think Oculus, HTC, I think a bunch of folks are basically in it, that are looking at the safety right. and looking at methodology for creating VR content, understanding mm-hmm. that they're bringing people and minds into this.
You're talking about psychological safety as well as physical safety?
Yeah, I believe so, yeah. yeah. I mean, it's basically like kind of creating standards that will allow for, frame rates and I mean, it goes more into the tech right, world okay, of it, right. but just basically like, we don't want to compromise anybody, right. obviously.
But do you, we watch horror movies.
And you're compromised constantly.
Exactly.
Yeah, I know.
So a horror movie in 3D though, maybe too, is it too horrific? Is it something we've got to get used to? Is it? Now, where do you see this transition?
Yeah, I mean, it's a responsibility for creators, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I wish I had an answer to that. I think that there's sometimes some use for it, I guess. I don't know what they are currently.
Because what's unusual about VR is that you're wondering what's behind your back, to your previous point, right? Particularly if you're constructing something like that, where it's something could be ominous.
Yeah.
Like, it reminds me of snorkeling a lot. And then if you're snorkeling,
there's a giant sea turtle behind you. Being
well, because I'm from Australia, I'm usually worried about a giant shark.
Yeah, yeah,
it's
sure.
just outside
I'm
my
like,
field
oh,
of vision.
I'm like, oh, the beautiful turtles, and you're like the deadly sharks.
Exactly.
got it.
But, you could really screw someone up, right?
You could very much, yeah. I mean, like, real life, if you try to freak someone out, like, have a guy with a gun behind you, I mean, that's not okay. And I do think that their reality has, there are some consequences and things that as filmmakers we need to, if we're in that space, anyone that's in the VR space that's coming from another medium need to understand that with embodiment comes a grave responsibility for not compromising someone.
Right.
There is an unfortunate example, but I haven't played, I think Resident Evil 7 is now in VR, and most people have been playing it there, but most people have been getting sick.
Already.
So, yeah. I don't know if that's...
Because of the motion or because of what the content?
Yeah, I think it's all technical stuff. Right, so right. But there's another one, Fallout 4. I don't think the port's complete yet, but right. the idea of Fallout... However many of you played Fallout 4 before? Okay. For those of you who don't know Fallout 4, it's like, post-apocalyptic, I imagine, like... society where you basically have a German Shepherd. I have a German Shepherd, so I quite like that. Where I'm prepared. Where your whole job is to, or the point is like you collect items and you create ways of surviving these gigantic monsters and zombie type people and so on. And you have weapons to do this. And big hazmat suits made out of metal, which is pretty steampunk and awesome. But there was a guy from Motherboard who was writing for Motherboard who went and played the VR piece at E3. It was like a demo. And he said the thing that he had a nightmare about and the only thing he could remember was holding a gun up to a zombie head. Like, in VR, holding a gun to someone's head.
Wow.
Like, when is that okay?
Right.
And that's the thing that frightens me the most about VR is that lack of responsibility.
Right.
That lack of understanding that compromises...
What would you want to do about that?
It's like gun control now. Like, how do you prevent actual people who shouldn't be buying guns from buying guns?
Right.
Like, you can hope that there's policies in place, but that only goes so far.
Right.
I mean, I think, keeping ourselves in check,
right.
flagging things when they're not right, hoping that the wisdom of crowds kind of helps protect
right.
it.
Right.
I know from a Google standpoint, like, I fight, and people on our team fight
right.
that. Headstrong. Like
fight it. What does the fight look like?
Well, I mean, it's like, okay, we can support 5 projects, and there are a lot of,
right.
there's some emphasis on like, well, shooting games were big.
Right.
And I'm like, no, I don't care how big they were. Like, I don't want that in this.
Right.
And so like you tend to try to fight it. I mean, it's the unfortunate dichotomy of, we have to find a way to have mass adoption to this, or there will be no reason for there to be content.
Right.
And without the need for content, content makers can't make content.
Right.
Some of the greatest content makers can't do it. So then you have to have both sort of situations. Mm-hmm. You have to have both things work together somehow.
Yeah.
So it's like, how do you do that quickly?
Right.
And it's
hard. Yeah, speed is the issue, right? Because every new technology has come with dystopian and utopian kind of discourses that wrap around it, and neither end up being quite true. But as this evolves, yeah, it's a matter of self-organizing, companies banding together.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things I would
governments
say...
slapping laws on top of you.
It's the same stuff.
Same
It's harder now. It's going to be a lot harder now. I mean, like, you're going to see... I mean, I'll tell you right now, it's hard to make stuff. Even a large corporation, you think it's not easy. I've been working there for a long time, and I see a lot of the old aesthetics that I brought to video and film for them being reused because the ideas are, like, slim pickings right now. And I find it's really funny to talk to an external group where it's like, you know, you have their team is made up of two people.
Right.
And they have to fight every day to find money for their projects. And I'm like, I'm also two people, and every day I have to fight money for projects that I want to do.
Right.
And it's just, you have to have, you have to work in this area where what you make is also something that will sell in some capacity or have interests or a baked in audience. So you find yourself sort of having to swim that stream as much as you can.
Maybe some people should come down. Are there mics somewhere around? But if you've got questions, then certainly start to get organized and come down. Because I also want to ask you, as we go toward that, the art making, you know, the role of VR, where things are stand in terms of the art world, in terms of imagination, the more speculative spaces.
Yeah.
How do you see things evolving there?
It's great.
Yeah.
It's so good. There's this artist, Rachel Rosen. And she's a friend, and I can't say names really. But she did this really great piece at Sundance, so, hence the cough coming from there, which was called The Sky is a Gap. And it was, she basically mapped time on your movement. So as you move forward and backwards, it would ramp, it would go through a scene, and the scene would go in reverse if you move backwards. Suddenly you were connected to this thing that was happening. And I remember one that was like a fridge that was on its side.
Right.
And as you moved forward towards it, it came towards you and was like barreling towards you and then would stop with like sushi coming out and like milk and orange juice and stuff. And it was really fascinating, like having physical properties sort of leveraging agency to then change the physics of what we believe reality to be like I think very, very cool.
And how do you figure out the sort of hyper-reality question? I mean, how abstract, how visually real?
As abstract as you can make it. I mean, my gosh, we don't understand reality very well. We're humans.
Right.
I think that there's a lot of really interesting ways that we can sort of use, like, I see red differently than you. Like, even the baseline of that.
Right.
How do you perceive deafness? Can you, from a visual, in a visual way? It turns out you can.
Right.
Even though you still don't have... And that kind of goes into the whole empathy thing that we've talked about, where you can have compassion, but empathy doesn't make any sense because you need all sorts of baked-in experiences that you yourself have not had in order to get to the point where that thing you're seeing actually affects you in the same way.
Yeah.
And I think that from a perception standpoint, that also becomes an interesting...
Maybe you could talk a little bit more about that, since you touched on it, the empathy thing, because as we were talking before, you know, again, photography and video and recording things and documenting things were supposed to make us free. And sometimes you could say the napalm girl running out of the village in Vietnam changed things, maybe, you know, to some degree. And other times it did not, whether the boy, the tragic Syrian boy on the beach is changing things or not. But
I mean,
people are putting a lot of store on empathy with VR, which...
Yeah, it's a word.
As a photographer, I'm a little suspicious
of it. It's fun because you say it, and then people kind of get the genre that you're going for.
Right.
So it's like this kind of odd labeling for a genre, but it doesn't really mean anything.
Mm.
Like, I think that it does mean... It could... I mean, achieving true empathy would be an astounding thing, but it's hard to do.
Right.
And I think that what we're seeing is mostly awareness and compassion, but I don't think we're seeing empathy. And I think that
And you make the distinction about one's lived experience?
I think it's lived experience, I mean, it's tough. Like, I don't expect you to look at, like, speaking of my dog, like, you won't look at my dog the same way I will, even though you see him and he's cute and he's furry. Mm. And you'll be like, from a baseline, like, from a from a general layer of, oh, okay, I like dogs.
Right.
You'd have to go down into, like, first dog she ever had, never had a big dog, went through all this training stuff with him to make him actually a good dog, had a shih tzu for a while, hated the shih tzu, like, this, like... You sort of go down this like path, had two dogs that she had when she was three. Like, you kind of have to, there's something really amazing about the depth of empathy and how like those layers and those shared, like if you can build up on these experiences and even focus on shared experience to get to that point, then you might have something closer. But just being in a refugee camp and seeing a refugee camp isn't empathy.
Right.
That's not how that happens.
Right.
Seeing a German Shepherd playing in a backyard is not empathy.
Right.
Like, and understanding how I see the world like that is, it's as if someone out there put a rig where you were sitting and was like, I know what it's like to be Tim Marshall. Like, no, no one knows what it's like to be you. Like, that's ridiculous.
Right.
Like,
right.
to assume that just by putting a rig where you're sitting has anything to do with who you are is,
right.
no, it's not
right.
It, right. at all it. And
right.
so I feel like there's a lot to be explored
right.
there.
So just, and then we'll go to the question, sorry.
Sorry about that, standing there.
This
so
is an interesting point. But what is happening? Is there a point to putting that rig in a refugee camp?
I think from I think there's going to be...
Actually, as I said earlier on, I was kind of surprised I was somewhat taken in a certain way. Well, it didn't make me empathic.
No, but I think it's
that
interesting.
Something different happened.
Being somewhere has ramifications.
Right.
It's really interesting to be in a place that
yeah.
You never thought you'd ever go
right.
or
right.
be.
Yeah.
I think that it's more about, I think that awareness and feeling compassion for what someone might feel being
right.
there is
right.
what you're achieving
right.
by
right.
doing that. I find that once, I would love it if there is someday when there is like more, you can live stream in
yeah.
VR in a wonderful
right.
way.
Yeah,
but basically like if, but by the people in the refugee camp, not because I'm a creator and I want to go in there and take from them.
Right.
I want them, I am so much more interested
right.
in going to where we believe there to be conflict and where folks are like, I need someone to help me talk about this.
Right.
And make this other people aware of it. I would rather teach them.
Right.
Give them a rig and say,
right.
whatever you feel.
You do it now.
Yeah.
So do you think we're getting close to the point where we could have greater access on the production side, not just on the consumption side?
I'm trying
side,
really so. Hard. I mean, it's difficult. I mean,
right.
it's, you know, because the infrastructure for VR is
yeah.
also not there. Like,
right.
you need the internet. Not
yeah.
many, you know, there.
Yeah. Exactly.
We are spoiled. I'm spoiled at Google. Sorry for having so much. I have the internet there in a lot,
yeah,
a lot of it.
It.
And I feel like,
I heard about that.
But if you go to, I mean, you go to Johannesburg, they have terrible infrastructure
yeah, right.
there. They're getting better, but they have great cell service. So you have to like find the right kind of VR technology that's going to allow for that to be leveraged,
right.
and that's the way that they
right.
are able to,
right.
to interact and,
right.
and so on.
I just wanted to ask about audio. You were talking a little bit about what a difference that makes, and then watching Resonance, I think it was called.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the first thing that stuck out to me is like, oh, what is that like when you turn around and, you know, suddenly this violinist is behind you? What are the tools, this might be sort of an elementary question, but
no,
like...
No, it's not, nothing, no such thing.
You know, what are the tools for creating like that sense of space, particularly with something like audio where it's so fickle?
Yeah, sure.
You know, how does that work? How do you go about trying to create that? And what are the limitations?
Oh, yeah. Well, I can tell you the limitations right now is that it's just the workflow is very complex. It actually can be simple. Like, there are simple ways of doing it, but it involves you going, like, writing out FFmpeg commands and using, like, probably, you know, Reaper, which is a great program, or so other programs that support spatial audio or ambisonics, and there are different orders of ambisonics. And the guy that was, like, working in ambisonics years ago that was, like, no one was paying attention to that guy, and suddenly he's just like the man,
nice.
Or the woman, I should say. So like they're all loving it. But the what we generally do, I have an audio guy named Luke Allen who works at a place called Silver Sound in New York, and he what he does is he comes in with like ambisonic mics and whatever the situation is. So if I'm like, filming an orchestra, we'll mic certain like we'll mic the conductor in case he says something. We'll mic certain instruments that we think are important. We'll have like a kind of a base on board the camera, just get a sense of the entire field. So, and then what you do is but he goes in and what he does is he mixes it and rotates it, the sound field appropriately for the rotation of the film. Generally, we try to like, I have to basically tell him this is front camera, and then he has to know how to spin his stuff so that, and take notes. So that when he goes in and matches those two things together, then he's able to know the rotation of it. So really the rotation in post is the problem, because as soon as I start rotating my stuff, like I keep changing that all the time.
Yeah.
Where like what I had as front cam in the scene may not be what front cam is, or what front cam, or its rotation will change depending on the edit. Because you imagine sort of that cipher, right? Yeah. You turn one, then everything else has to kind of turn. So he loves me. But like he has to go back in and rotate things appropriately.
Yeah, and I mean, and then like you turn, like as the viewer.
Well, so the great
right?
thing about it is the technology is this is layman's way of, because I'm not an engineer, but
neither am I.
I play one on TV. FFmpeg is basically the way that you append the spatialized audio with the video, so that when you do turn, the sound field responds to that. So basically, as long as you have those two things appended in that way, and YouTube actually has support for spatialized audio, so if you do have this, if you put it on YouTube, it actually will keep that information. So like if you go to my channel now, everything you see has spatialized audio, so you can actually, except for the Deep Dream stuff, because I just couldn't, I was like, this is enough, the visual is fine. So that's sort of the production trajectory of that. If it's helpful. I mean, there's actually great documentation. The Jump team had posted some stuff on ambisonics and how that works as well. So.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah,
thank
sure.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Hello, Jessica.
Hi.
How are you?
Good, how are you doing?
Good.
This is great.
So I have a question for you, since you are a woman in a very heavily dominated field, male-dominated field. Do you ever feel like you are in a heavily male-dominated field? And also, were you ever stopped because you were a woman?
I never let that affect my work. I'm sure it has, but I'd rather be known for the work than my gender. I think most women and men or other would agree. I think that being as visible as I am right now I was in film for a while. I mean, forget that. I mean, like, VR is actually the amount of women that are doing great stuff in this field is really, it's good. And they have a lot of exposure. Mm. You know, the men in the field have been extremely supportive. I think it's something that we kind of constantly have to keep in check a little bit, because I say that, and then in San Francisco, there was this really large conference, and you scrolled, and it was like, white men. Just pages. And even I'm just like, okay, you know, like they probably, it was like all, I mean, it was sickening. I was like, but this isn't VR at all. Like, and then finally I saw Resh, who's my friend, this is gonna sound awful, but my Indian friend that works at Frame Store. And I'm like, yeah, Resh, great. And then, wait. And so I think it's, you know, it's just, it's a visibility thing. It's like people are like, that will affect who believes they can do this sort of thing.
Right.
So let me be your champion, I guess. If you're thinking that it's, you know, half Singaporean, you know, a woman VR maker. If the visibility of me gives other women or men the idea of what VR is and who is there working, great. Yeah. I won't go out on a pedestal and say, you know, I'm a woman who works in VR. Respect me. It's like I work in VR. Here are my crazy thoughts. And this too.
Thanks.
Yeah.
So I don't know anything about VR filmmaking aside from today. So this might not be a very well-formed question. But in listening, I sometimes wonder if there is a false dichotomy between quote like experiential and narrative storytelling,
mm-hmm.
because you know whenever you obviously. Make choices or do one thing instead of another, you're limiting the viewer's experience in some way. And, you know, the idea that VR filmmaking is, that what it can do is put you in a room or a refugee camp or a cave or something and you look around, that's sort of like, that'd be like thinking what filmmaking can do is show you a picture of a train, like that's what it started with, but then you have, you know, narrative and editing and style and so on.
Yeah.
And I don't know, are there like filmmakers who are working on, sort of something that's in not one end or the other, like not just here you are, walk around, oh, hey, a bird, and not I'm sitting in one place and showing you a linear story, but something sort of with both.
That's really the issue.
Yeah,
that's
absolutely.
Evolving, I suppose.
I am also your champion for that too. I believe in the ebb and flow of that actually quite a bit, where sometimes it's direct and sometimes it's not. So sometimes it is, you're walking around and you see a bird, but sometimes the next shot is, you know, like a few of us have been talking about, like, you know, and my friend Katie has done some great research in this as well, but it's with the D school, I think it's D school, with Stanford, and where you, sometimes you want like a 90 or a 180, not a 360. Like sometimes it's about isolating how much information you give to someone or you allow for someone to have in order to then have a direct understanding of maybe what you need to be paying attention to or need to be paying attention to.
You mean you're weaving together linear and non-linear, less linear and more linear?
It's not binary. Yeah. I think to your point, it shouldn't be binary.
You're oscillating in some way?
Yeah, it has to be an oscillation and it's never one or the other completely. Right. I think it's how open you are in expanding it, how direct you are, or how much you compel as a creator versus how much you let the visitor do what she needs to do. Yeah. That's how this stuff will transcend what it is now. But I think it's very important to do that. That was great.
Yeah, it's a great question. Thank you.
So there was an earlier panel about VR education, and I just wondered if you had some thoughts on who's doing the best sort of VR education right now, where to go for the best mentorship, and just what it's going to take to really bring this to more institutions and also just to the public in terms of pedagogy.
Oh, that's great. Well, we had Google has a program called Expeditions, which basically provides cardboard units and sort of a means for teachers to actually take kids on virtual field trips. It's not video. I don't think it's video. It's still stills. But I would have loved to have gone to the American Museum of Natural History if I could have, you know, as a rural Pennsylvanian. That's another layer. Yeah, farmland. Hi. No access to anything for a long time. But lots of corn. So for me, that's really great. It's like the access to these institutions. A lot of them are actually really excited about doing a lot of aquariums, want to do it, museums. I feel like they're also starting to really think now about like how do we reinvent the museum for someone virtually? Like what can a museum do that in a virtual space that it can't do in a real space? Then you think about AR, like how can you use AR while you're actually in a museum to then engage with someone in a way that is, that maybe like one of the dreams of mine is like there's a dinosaur it's the Barosaurus, I think, that's in the front of the, Tim's like, I don't know, the front of the American Museum of Natural History that's wrong, it's rearing back, and it's actually too big to be rearing back. And they have it on t-shirts and posters. And like they can't just change that thing like in a day. It's a big dino. And I was thinking like, you know, with AR, if you're able to actually look at it and if, say museums don't have the budget or for timing purposes, they can't do anything, but then you see the museum correct itself in a virtual space. So you see the dinosaur rearing back suddenly fall forward and this looks at you. Like something as simple as that. So I think from an education standpoint, there's a number of things. Bringing things that are easily accessible, like cardboard. People can use their cell phones now and be able to use YouTube and see all sorts of great stuff on iPhone or on Android. So it's a hardware agnostic, right? I think it's about. I think in terms of education material, it's sort of like I don't really know. I haven't been following it that specifically to know who to follow.
And what about just teaching it or bringing it to higher education?
Oh, you mean like VR?
Teaching VR filmmaking or VR?
Yeah, I mean, some schools are trying very hard to do it. Oddly enough, they're reading my Medium blog and using it as like things that kids have to do, which is flattering, and I didn't expect that would happen.
I'm
like, I'm just like typing away at my apartment, and this happens. But the I think that what I do for myself is like I actually, when I have insights that I think are important, and when I have the time, I'll publish something on Medium, which has been great. And so I have like this kind of language of VR publication that people have been using as references and as ways of understanding things better. In terms of higher education, NYU's been doing great. I imagine New School, Parsons, getting into it. I think it's really hard. I think it's a bit tough to tell an older institution to teach VR because they don't know what that means, and there aren't enough people that are doing it right now that want to stop everything and teach, like me being that person. Like, so the best thing we can do is occasionally pop into like a film class or like something that's like similar to ITP, where you can basically say like, hey, VR, this is what's happening, hope that helps, and then leave. But there are a lot of resources online, basically, that I would recommend. It's gonna solidify at some point, but we're still figuring so much of it out that we have to be kind of cautious about teaching it too early.
With a place like us, because we do a lot of studio teaching, there's also teaching with VR, not mm-hmm. just teaching VR. So
yeah, it's almost like
taking that online has been very hard, but in VR, maybe that's a whole new world opens
up. You learn a lot by watching and finding stuff and kind of thinking on what seems to be working for you. But again, like I said, it's not a plug for my Medium blog at all. It seems to be helping folks. So if you find it.
Last question, we're running out of time.
Tim and Jessica, hi.
Hi.
Hey, thank you so much for doing this.
Sure.
The very first panel, something stuck out that I hadn't considered. A fellow named, I think, Sultan Baradawala presented an idea that's been bugging me, and I wanted to see what you thought. What you've been presenting seems to feel like VR or AR as or MR. What even is that? But
reality.
Take it off.
But the approach kind of as haunted house, sort of like how everything's curated in a certain way, and there's a probability of like once the person's in that, like where they might be looking and how you might affect that accordingly.
Yeah.
But he did this nifty thing where he had his favorite place in the world and then created a manner where he could talk to his brother in India via avatar, but it was sort of like VR as, instead of haunted house, as treehouse, kind of like where it's a place where you meet, but instead of letting the VR have the onus of doing the magic thing, the magic still came from interacting with the other person in the place. And I just wanted to gather your thoughts on VR as a place to be rather than something that has to perform, if that makes any sense. And,
sure, yeah. I mean, the limitations of what I'm working in right now is the reason that I have, that's why I look at it the way that I do.
Sure.
I think from what, in terms of interactivity, representation of other people in the space, like social, I think that there is some really great things that can happen there. I worry about it being slapped on, kind of like the Deep Dream stuff, where it's like, it's cool because I can talk to somebody else. And it's like, yeah, but like what, like for me, avatars are really weird. Like, I'm like, well, like photorealistic avatars, where I'm like,
so weird.
I know, it's like Second Life again, where I'm like, I'm flying, but I'm a demon chick, I don't know. But I stopped pretty quickly. I'm not a big, I don't know. I feel like there's something in terms of representation of other people in spaces that I find very fascinating, especially in light of current events. I talked to a friend of mine, Ali, who's in Iran right now, works in VR, talked about finding a way to bring his stuff here for something. And he was like, he can't go to South by Southwest, and his piece is there, because stuff, I know. So we started talking about ways that you could represent someone who isn't there in a virtual space next to a piece of work that they've done, or how can you incorporate a voice or someone's like essence in a space? So I feel like they're going to be, it's like fun and bubbly and like kind of wee-like when you're like, oh great, I can talk to my friends. But I think there's also something really powerful to communication. Mm-hmm. And again, it's a tension point where it's like, how am I convinced that person is there? And how is that person convinced that they're there? And how am I convinced that person and I are actually having a conversation?
Right.
So I feel like there's some really interesting stuff to dig in on that front, and I'm excited. I'm looking at interactivity now in the social space and sick stuff and all that stuff. So I'm really thinking about expanding what I've been learning to kind of see what else is possible.
Cool.
Yeah.
Thanks. Okay.
I love that sign.
There's a sign. Yep, we're
just
time
like,
over.
What's up?
Thank you very much. So please join me in thanking
Thank
Jessica.
You.
Thank you.
Thanks.
It's totally fascinating. I learned a lot.